To answer your first question, because I wanted the challenge of doing one of these for a movie that I can acknowledge is good, even if it's not a particular favorite of mine. Now don't get me wrong, I like Titanic just fine, it's one of those movies that's hard not to watch when you stumble across it on cable, but would it make my Desert Island movie collection? Hell no. Well, maybe a couple minutes of it. Here's the thing, the point of Really That Good is to explore exactly why some of the biggest and most popular movies became so big and popular in the first place, and the fact that it even felt like there was a question as to whether or not to do one of these for a movie that won 11 Oscars, had one of the most impressive box office runs of all time, and was for a good long while the biggest hit ever, well, that question pretty much answers itself, doesn't it? Titanic is a movie that wasn't simply loved, it was beloved, but it also immediately became a target of scorn and ridicule, and among plenty of present-day would-be film intelligentsia, mocking it and taking it to task for its supposed egregious flaws and crimes against quality filmmaking was something like a rite of passage for a long time. The level of hate that continues to get thrown Titanic's way would be weird and noteworthy even if the movie wasn't good, just because of the pedigree involved. There's a certain point where if you pack enough good actors, credible subject matter, and noteworthy filmmakers into one project, people will bend over backwards to pretend it's good even if it's one of the worst things anyone involved ever did. Ahem. And considering the presence of two of the most celebrated actors of their generation, one of the most successful filmmakers of all time, and the most respectable genre Hollywood has in the historical tragic drama, even if Titanic did suck as much as people insist it does, you'd think it'd warrant cautious reconsideration on that alone.
Do you know of Dr. Freud, Mr. Ismay? His ideas about the male preoccupation with size might be of particular interest to you.
On the flip side, the film absolutely does have fans, whether it's people who just simply liked this movie that they and everyone else saw and will happily watch it either by choice or just because it's on, with no care paid to the idea that someone on film Twitter is quietly judging them somewhere, or a generation and counting of diehard fans for whom Titanic really is one of their favorite media experiences ever. And while the haters will certainly warrant some unavoidable discussion, it's this reaction to James Cameron's Titanic that we're going to be more focused on here. Does one of the biggest movies of all time deserve the love it continues to get, or do the haters, with the benefit of hindsight, have a point? Is Titanic really that good?
You know somebody?
Of course not, that's not the point.
Goodbye, I'll miss you!
Goodbye!
Goodbye!
I'm gonna never forget you!
Why was this movie so big, and why does it continue to endure? The general consensus when it was coming out was that Titanic was going to be a disaster that could never hope to make its budget back and probably wasn't worth blowing that much money and effort on in the first place. It was too long, historical movies weren't generally burning up the box office in the mid-90s, and why was an expensive movie in a genre usually aimed at older audiences being built around a romance story for teenagers? But once it dropped, it wasn't just a hit, it was a cultural sensation, a must-see event that seemed to cross dozens of demographic lines, despite being slightly whiter than a box of Minute Rice at a Donald Trump rally, and implausibly united the otherwise utterly divergent tastes of Academy Award voters and 14-year-old girls. And as the most convincing evidence of all that this was a unique success, every attempt to replicate it has fallen flat on its face. You know, folks, there's a temptation to sometimes treat Really That Good like a showcase for some kind of cinematic detective skill, as though I'm gonna stumble on some profound clue to the mechanism of why a given film has accrued its appreciation that somehow everyone else has managed to miss. And in those cases, this part of the episode is sometimes more interesting. But if it's not there, you can't fake it, and try as I might, there is no big secret to why Titanic clicked with its audience. It's just a well-made movie. The framing device about the heart of the ocean pendant provides a solid mystery to keep us interested, even though everyone knows what happened to the Titanic itself, and it makes for a clever parallel with the main narrative's running theme of proud men overlooking what's right in front of them. The plot construction is rock solid, and even though the film is extremely long, pretty much every scene feels necessary and pays off accordingly. The stakes are clear and relatable, the B and C stories complement the primary narrative effectively, and even though the plot basically turns on an almost literal act of God, it all plays fair and works out to emotionally satisfying ends. In fact, the aforementioned extra length allows the film to avoid the common disaster movie mistake of descending too far into artificial action cliches until it's appropriate and unavoidable, with much of the post-iceberg sequences concentrated on the thousands of tiny things that go wrong in the response to the collision and the domino effect of organizational failings, petty human malfeasance that inexorably transform the Titanic disaster into the Titanic tragedy, and that's a lot more interesting than just setting off random trouble to keep things kinetic, and it lets them save all of that for the very end where it belongs. And yeah, yeah, you can probably put most of that on James Cameron. Say what you like about some of his more offbeat creative flourishes and particular hang-ups, the man is a fearsomely accomplished technician filmmaker, and that level of rock-solid acumen extends to his skills as a storyteller. You may not care for the stories he tells, but it's hard to deny that he does it well. Yeah, fine, Avatar didn't deliver enough depth or originality to actually last, but in the moment, people were caught up in it, otherwise it wouldn't have made all that money, and Titanic is basically a better version of the same scenario. The whole poor boy, rich girl thing may be indeed hokey as hell by the time you get to the lobby, but in the theater, people were sobbing their goddamn eyes out, and you know it.
Promise. Never let go. I'm gonna let go, Jack. I'll never let go.
It's also an absolutely gorgeous looking movie, presenting a glossy, postcard-perfect vision of history as memory that still feels like the template for big-scale historical dramas set in any time other than World War II. Does the then-revolutionary CGI all hold up? Not in all cases, but it holds up better than most other similar work of the time, and the heavy integration of practical sets and real conditions helps a lot. Yeah, I bet it was miserable to shoot with all that water and endurance acting, but it's all up there on screen, and it makes you really appreciate what it must really have been like to be on a sinking ship, even though the vast majority of us never have or never will be. The cinematographer on this was Russell Carpenter, who has an eclectic filmography to say the least. He just did Ant-Man, in fact, but there's no denying he shot the hell out of Titanic. Yeah, the sinking stuff looks great, but think about how many instantly iconic shots there are in this movie that have nothing to do with the stuff everyone ostensibly showed up to see.
Women and children towards the front
finish. You unimaginable bastard.
They certainly were a waste of money.
The difference between Cal's taste in art and mine is that I have some.
You're still my best girl, Cora.
But all the technical acumen in the world can't turn a movie into a long-lived classic. Just ask some of James Cameron's other movies. To really stick in the public imagination, you need great characters realized through great performances, and Titanic has those. Oh, some of you disagree? Okay, let's talk about that. Most people who are nominally informed about art and culture recognize that different mediums of dramatization tell their stories in different ways, and that the tone, tenor, and rhythm that may be demanded by one medium may be unwelcome in another. What constitutes a good performance in pantomime doesn't necessarily translate to good performance at the opera. Where a lot of even well-versed persons almost run into trouble is assuming that the same isn't also true within mediums, i.e. the assumption that there's only one definition of good film acting, for example. It may sound like solid reasoning, but just as you don't use the same cinematography and editing for a comedy as you do for a gothic horror film, styles of acting that might be the absolute wrong decision for one genre can easily be the best possible way to go for another. Stylistically, Titanic is a melodrama, which Webster's defines as a work as a movie or play characterized by extravagant theatricality and by the predominance of plot and physical action over characterization. Melodrama also typically involves heightened, exaggerated emotions and broadly sketched arch characters. And before you ask, we can all tell that Titanic embraces melodrama deliberately rather than just stumbling into it through lack of restraint or discipline, because the present-day framing device scenes are pointedly not melodramatic and feature modern, naturalistic performances along with a marked change in tone and visual aesthetic to differentiate the two periods and hammer home that most of what we're watching is a story being related by Old Rose.
Pretty cool, huh?
Thank you for that fine forensic analysis, Mr. Bodine. Of course, the experience of it was somewhat different.
In fact, establishing some part of a dramatic narrative as being heightened or unreal to designate it as a dream or a memory is one of the most frequent uses of melodrama as a style in modern filmmaking. Hell, it could even be argued that Titanic's often criticized fairy tale romance storytelling is stylistically deliberate because we are being told a story, and for all we know, it's being embellished or rendered in arch good versus evil terms by the teller.
Do you want to hear this or not, Mr. Lovett?
Or not. I mean, for that to be even worth considering, why Old Rose would have to somehow prove herself an unreliable narrator by leaving out some key important detail of her own story. And that's just crazy talk. Besides, how can you not be melodramatic about an event in history where this is supposedly one of the things that did happen?
Gentlemen. play with you tonight.
In any case, Titanic is a melodrama, and in the context of a melodrama, the main cast all hit exactly the right note. Leonardo DiCaprio is an ideal working-class Prince Charming, Billy Zane is a bastard for the ages as the villain, Gloria Stewart killed it as Old Rose, David Warner is a great henchman, Kathy Bates gives great comic relief as Molly Brown, Victor Garber and Bernard Hill ooze tragic gravitas. Look, if this movie was an orchestra, it'd have a double-sized percussion section, and everyone would be mainly asked to hit the same note as hard as possible over and over again, but they hit it basically every goddamn time. The MVP, though, is unquestionably Kate Winslet.
Jack, I want you to draw me like one of your French girls. Wearing this.
All right.
Wearing only this.
Now, Winslet is one of the best actresses of her generation, and not only is she given a succession of more nuanced, complex, and frankly better performances since Titanic, she was doing it before Titanic 2. But just because Titanic wasn't her best role, doesn't mean she doesn't act the shit out of it. This is Rose's story, told by Rose, and appropriately, she's the only character who has true multidimensionality, which means she has to run the emotional and physical gamut from scene to scene and somehow convince us that this, and this are all natural facets of the same character. And not only does she pull it off, she kills it. You find me another actress in 1997 who can go from classy to smoldering to swinging a freaking axe around and be this convincing.
Oh, Mother. Shut up!
Bottom line, Titanic works because it's great entertainment, compelling and emotionally involving in a way that only well-staged melodrama really can be. And on those merits, it's as perfect an example of the form as one can imagine. So this is the part where we usually, as the title says, dig a little deeper, but like I said before, it's kinda pointless to try and go deeper when it comes to Titanic. There just isn't a deeper to get to. It's a deliberately simple, archetypal melodrama with noble heroes and sinister villains that grabs the heartstrings and will not let go, and it's right up front about that fact succeeding within those parameters. Cut, print, done, put down the shovel, we've found the water table. So instead, I'm gonna use this space to examine why the success of Titanic, and more substantively, the culture's embrace of Titanic, seem to rub so many people the wrong way, and lead to it being a question as to whether or not it's any good in the first place. I.e., it's time to talk about... When Titanic was first being promoted, i.e. when the two studios backing the project were setting expectations and talking things up in advance of what everyone knew would have to be an absolutely monstrous box office take in order to turn any kind of profit, the film was being marketed as a typical disaster movie. You can see it in this pre-release teaser poster, which features the title cast in ominous industrial steel and angled down to imply that the sinking of the boat will be the main focus of the story and the action-centric tagline, "Collide with Destiny." Now yes, this was before Cameron had handed in his final cut of the movie, in fact they were still shooting it, but the studio investors had seen the screen play. It's not as if nobody knew that Cameron's movie was planned from the beginning as being primarily a melodramatic romance about two starry-eyed young people falling in deliriously starry-eyed young people love. That was the movie they agreed to make. So why was the earliest possible pitch to sell what ended up being one of the most popular romantic movies of all time making its earliest pitch as being just another 90s disaster movie? Well, you already know why. Until it was unavoidable, they didn't want people to think they'd made a girl movie.
Oh my dear. The dreadful bridesmaids' gowns. Let me tell you what an odyssey that has been. Rose decided she wanted lavender. She knows I detest the color, so she did it off the spot. If ever you come to me sooner. Ruth stole some of my designs in La Mode Illustrée. They were the trousseau of the Duchess of Marlborough's youngest daughter. They were quite charming. But I think you'll agree, my dear, that together we've created something of a phoenix from the ashes.
Let's be very honest about something. The quickest way for any work of art, fiction, or other popular culture ephemera to cease being taken seriously is for the broader culture to intuit that it was made for or enjoyable by women, especially teenage girls. This is not up for debate, we're not having a feminism argument here, all you need to do is live in the culture and look around a little and you already know this is a fact. That melodrama thing we talked about earlier, one of the reasons it fell out of favor as opposed to naturalistic drama in the West is that the style became predominantly associated with television soap operas, a genre that overwhelmingly catered to women and thus was thought to not be worth taking seriously. Now, I imagine there will be some resistance to this idea since, yes, there has been a Herculean and yet still sorely lacking effort to turn this paradigm around within the last decade or so, particularly in Hollywood and the media, but it's been absolutely true for much longer. Entertainment aimed at art and women is generally looked down on by the broader popular culture, not because of some grand conspiracy, but largely because of a variety of social conditioning factors that were held up as normal long enough to become things much of the culture does just by reflex. Remember remember, a huge amount of meaningful pop culture entertainment and leisure activity, by and large, was thought of as only for men for a good deal of Western history. So went the logic, men, here meaning white property owners of standing, were the gender burdened by so-called natural law with the obligation to work and provide for the family, ergo they were the most in need of, and most entitled to, special activities as a necessary reward for the same. Women? What the hell were women possibly doing that was so taxing as to need a respite from it? And so it followed that any entertainment, art, or leisure activity that was appealing to women had to, by extension, be a frivolous waste of time. Now, as a certain amount of arduously slow to increase gender parity began to slowly emerge in the late 19th and 20th century West, this paradigm actually got a little bit better, sort of, in some respects. Most relevantly to our current topic, so-called women's films were a hugely important and profitable genre in the golden age of Hollywood, a phenomenon that was ultimately undone by the collapse of the original studio system, the rise of the blockbusters, and the parallel migration of so-called women's stories to television. Now, before people freak out, yes, it is currently true that there are things in entertainment tagged predominantly for women that the popular culture will look at you askance for not bowing down to and worshipping, but that's a recent development, and it certainly wasn't how things were when Titanic hit in the 90s.
You will honor me the way a wife is required to honor a husband, because I will not be made out of fool rules. Is this in any way unclear?
No.
Good. Excuse me.
Now, oh sure, you could make money off women's entertainment in the 90s, but the cost was that you were going to be mocked open season style to the point where you were likely never going to be taken seriously again. The rise of boy bands was treated like a sonic Armageddon, the worst thing that ever happened to music. The Spice Girls made one fairly innocuous dumb little movie, and the film press acted like someone had taken a shit on the only surviving 70mm print of Lawrence of Arabia. The words romantic comedy were used as an automatic punchline synonym for shitty movie by cinephile snobs, much in the way that superhero movie is today. Save for a few rare exceptions, no matter how popular, the overall cultural perception was that appealing to women was basically anathema to credibility. So yeah, pop culture was skeptical about Titanic from the get-go, but once it became the prevailing perception that the most popular movie in the world, assumed to be most popular movie of all time, was having its success overwhelmingly driven by a female audience and by the teenage girl audience in particular, the knives came out. If you looked up a takedown of Titanic 9 times out of 10, you were going to see the fact that it was beloved by the so-called Tiger Beat set, cited as ipso facto evidence of its shortcomings, as though young women were so universally agreed to have terrible taste that their endorsement was an automatic black spot, because as we all know, nothing that draws a crowd of hyper-enthusiastic screaming teenage girls is ever culturally worthwhile, right? Right?
What's the artist's name?
Something Picasso?
Something Picasso? He won't amount to a thing. He won't, trust me.
All the major criticisms of the film became filtered through the prism of its presumed fanbase. The tone couldn't just be called melodrama, the film was a soap opera, or 90210. The characters weren't archetypes, they were simple and immature. Oh, and hey, this was also the period where the film fandom discourse was being rapidly overtaken by the internet fanboy message board set, and we all know how that community has historically felt about women. Nowhere was this backlash against Titanic for being a girl movie more pronounced than what happened to its male star, Leonardo DiCaprio. It's easy to forget, but when this guy first showed up outside of Growing Pains, he was immediately tipped as a natural-born acting superstar, perhaps an heir to the likes of Brando and James Dean, and male film geeks, they loved him. He was cool, especially because he made cool movies about cool stuff, like daddy issues and teenage boy angst. He was all set. The reigning assumption was that this kid would be piling up Oscars for however long he wanted to. And then he made Titanic and became the most hated male actor among men on the planet.
Come on! You know I didn't do it! You know me!
And I'll cop to being part of the problem. I was in high school when Titanic was doing its thing, and I absolutely was in lockstep with every other asshole teenage boy my age in hating this quote-unquote pretty boy for being the ubiquitous chick sex symbol of our generation, and seething in resentment over how much we assumed he was occupying the thoughts of our female peers, because I was a teenage boy and thus a stupid, angsty ball of concentrated masculine insecurity. And because teenage boy culture hated Leonardo DiCaprio, that meant that movie geek fanboy culture hated Leonardo DiCaprio. So suddenly, this ultra-promising young actor was now recast in popular imagination as a Tiger Beat pinup getting by on his looks. And if you're skeptical about whether or not that nonsense gradually bled over into his overall cultural profile, here's a sampling of the extremes he's gone to since Titanic to essentially shed that perception.
No. And you're still acting like an infant!
God damn it!
Ah! Gotcha!
Yeah, we all noticed this, right? That Leonardo DiCaprio's post-Titanic prestige career path has basically been received as a succession of physical torment in penance for the mortal sin of having been that kid from Titanic whose existence made dudes resentful in the 90s. Not that I think that's how he sees it, but it feels like a lot of certain stripes of film culture absolutely did. All right, you basically fed yourself to a bear. I guess that makes up for the boat movie. You can have your Oscar now. Please choose the unclaimed Marvel and/or DC superhero property of your choice and earn your retirement island. Now look, this isn't to say that if you didn't like Titanic then or don't like it now, you're a sexist or some other hyperbolic bullshit, but the story of this movie is the story of a shockingly rare moment in time when the biggest and most influential thing in popular culture was mainly the purview of young women, and the fact that popular culture organisms so violently rejected that deviation from the norm has everything to do with the film's unusual post-release life, in terms of those who still love it, those who still hate it, why its quality is worth exploring at this length, and everything in between. But here's the thing, a giant blockbuster targeting, whether by design or by happenstance, an audience that doesn't typically get targeted by giant blockbusters can explain some of Titanic's incredible success, but does it explain everything about why this movie got so dug in and seemed to speak to people so deeply, or was there something else going on? So a basic understanding of the function of melodrama in popular storytelling and a somewhat broad understanding of gender dynamics in popular culture can tell you why Titanic worked for the audience at large and really worked for a specific audience of devoted fans, but it doesn't quite explain why the film so profoundly got its hooks into the global psyche, because for that to happen, something generally has to be connecting deeply on a thematic level. But as we've already established, Titanic isn't big on depth or nuance and doesn't really have deeper thematic levels, so what gives? Well, I'd posit that sometimes a cultural phenomenon doesn't need to be exploring themes deeply, namely times when a work arrives as the only cultural product that's bothering to have that conversation at all. Now, as we've discussed, Titanic really only has one major theme. Class. Haves and have-nots, rich and poor, first class and steerage. Now that feels like something we talk about a lot today, but in the 90s, quick, name another pop culture institution, especially from Hollywood, even approaching Titanic's scale, to zero in on that particular theme in that same era. Yeah, I thought so, huh? So, why was that?
Hi there! My name is Bob, and I make this show, and several others. So, this next part of the episode includes a discussion of the political climate of the 1990s, which, by its nature, includes some discussion of the Clinton administration, and has some not terribly flattering things to say about said administration. Now, here's the thing, folks. Really That Good takes a long time to make. Just to give you some semblance of time frame here, this right here is the very last big piece of production I'm doing for this episode, and for a timestamp, Castro just died about an hour ago. So this next part of the Titanic retrospective was written mostly throughout the month of October, at which point we did not realize that we would not be getting a second Clinton administration, and that instead the United States of America, the voters of the United States of America, would instead decide to roll the dice and see what it would be like to be governed for 4 years by pumpkin spice Berlusconi. As such, I understand that less than flattering portraits of any Clinton administration is not exactly what I imagine the bulk of my viewership really wants to hear right now. So I just wanted to mark down for the record that just because this next segment is a bit on the cynical side about the Clintons and the 1990s and post-1990s Democrat Party in general, doesn't mean I'm looking to kick Hillary supporters when they're down. I mean, good lord, I am one. Don't get me wrong, I stand behind everything I'm about to say that you're about to hear, and I'm not saying that I would have phrased it differently or I wish I'd said something different. I just wanted to jump in here and clarify where I stand before someone, like, screen caps this all out and turns it into part of the self-hating Democrat narrative that has come about in recent weeks, because that is just not what I ever wanted it to be, folks. I now return you to the episode, which I hope you have been enjoying, and let's get through the next 4 years of this shit together.
Okay, quick history lesson. Ronald Reagan brought the Republican Party back to life in the 1980s and tilted American political consciousness massively to the right for the first time in several generations by recognizing that white baby boomers, the largest and thus most powerful voting bloc that had ever existed in U.S. national politics to that point, were heading into their 30s, and that while for a time that generation had been nominally committed to progressivism, civil rights, and social justice, a lot of them had only really ever shown up for the music, the culture, the free love, and the drugs. And now that they were en masse moving to the suburbs, buying cars and houses, starting 2.5-kid families, and getting white-collar jobs, pensions, and mortgages, they could be persuaded to vote for a vision of conservatism that was heavy on retro-optimist boomer nostalgia and short on concrete policy outside of stop asking questions and I'll make you richer. Which, of course, was a much better pitch in the 80s than the gloomy, oh, let's all talk about depressing things like poverty and ecological destruction angle the party pooper left was still stuck on, right? But in the 90s, the Clintons showed up and turned the tables for liberalism by effectively hijacking that Reagan-esque optimism in a triangulation strategy that was called the Third Way, but was really about having it both ways. See, it's easy to forget because of how successfully the Clintons repackaged themselves as more small-c conservative to win re-election in 1996, but when Bill and Hill first showed up in 92, they wore OG boomer radicalism like it was a professional wrestling gimmick. Hey folks, I'm a dope-smoking, draft-dodging, rock-and-rolling ex-hippie, and check out my ball-busting militant feminist wife who totally wants to be president herself, aren't we novel? But they were just as outwardly a quintessential yuppie power couple. Lots of money, lots of class, comfy retirement plan, well-behaved college-bound kid, looked good in formal wear. Cool 60s politics, slick 80s living. That was the genius of Bill Clinton's campaign pitch, that boomers could absolve themselves of the growing sense that they'd sold out their youthful idealism by voting for Reagan in the 80s, by voting for him in the 90s. Now, to be sure, the Clinton presidency absolutely did move the needle for real incremental progress in its own way, but that's for a political show, and this digression has probably been going on too long already. The point we're concerned with is that the direct segue from Reagan-Bush conservatism to Clinton liberalism, you basically had two solid decades where the mainstream American left-right discourse and its strong influence on the discourse of the broader Western world, yes, I see you there, creepy ghost of Mrs. Thatcher, basically stopped talking about class and poverty, which meant popular culture was utterly dominated by concerns of and conflicts within the affluent boomer middle class. Oh sure, once in a while there was a documentary or a niche drama on HBO, but for the most part it just didn't come up in mainstream popular culture outside of a very special episode of something or if there was a giant city-destroying riot. The mainstream pop image of poverty for a lot of the 90s, Roseanne and Dan Connor, who ran their own business and lived in a house I couldn't afford if there were seven of me. The only segment of even remotely popular entertainment regularly talking about class issues was hip-hop, and despite the impression you might have gotten from Straight Outta Compton, mainstream culture didn't really start giving the genre its due until it segued from gangster rap to party anthems. Anyway, this is the cultural milieu into which Titanic emerged, a massive mainstream movie that everyone felt they had to see that just happened to make class disparity its central theme because what the hell else do you do with a Titanic movie?
Don't you understand? The water is freezing and there aren't enough boats. Not enough by half. Half the people on this ship are going to die.
Not the better half.
When they finish putting the first class people in the boats, they'll be starting with us and we'll want to be all ready, won't we?
Well, thank you. We are dressed in our best and are prepared to go down as gentlemen.
But we would like a brandy.
And while it's blunt, surface level, this is a thing that exists, treatment of that theme may not amount to much in terms of meaningful weight and thus reads a bit perfunctory in this era of Bernie and Black Lives Matter, in a vacuum, sometimes all something needs to do is be. That's not to suggest that James Cameron somehow planted the seeds of Occupy Wall Street, or that activists living day-to-day in the urban blight of America's forgotten inner cities went to see Titanic and thought, oh wow, that baby-faced tiger beat white boy really speaks to my struggle. But at a moment when Hollywood didn't want to say anything, a hugely accessible, finally tuned crowd pleaser said, well, something. And if you're looking for some extra spark of psychological thematic novelty that could have conceivably helped an otherwise basic movie like Titanic catch fire, maybe, just maybe, it's because even in a trite cartoonish way, it was saying something people didn't know they'd gone too long without hearing.
Tell us of the accommodations and steerage, Mr. Dawson. I hear they're quite good on this ship.
The best I've seen, ma'am. Hardly any rats.
So here's what's not going to happen here. Remember a moment ago when we explored how Titanic was massively over-scrutinized as a result of a largely gender-based backlash in the cinephile film geek community? One of the ways that manifested was ridiculous nitpicking. Every otherwise well-made movie had its share of trivial filmmaking and research flaws, but we really only ever hear about them when people get obsessed with taking down a particular movie. And the fact that Titanic was at one point the IMDb record holder for movie mistakes is thus the opposite of a meaningful thing. So no, we're not going to talk about dumb continuity errors or extras missing their cue or interesting but meaningless business like Jack describing a lake that didn't exist yet or the stars not being in the correct position, even though the fact that we can track that is legit fascinating, and I think that what people miss about Dr. Tyson's pop culture critic shtick is that he's using it as an opportunity to point out extraordinary scientific feats as opposed to picking on things, but that's neither here nor there. Or the physics of whether or not Jack and Rose could have both fit on that stupid door, none of that. We're gonna talk about real stuff, starting right here. As far as we know, that shit didn't happen. Now look, historical melodrama is gonna take narrative liberties in cases where the ultimate fates of certain people are unknown. We don't know if the ship's designer was futzing with the clock at the end, we don't actually know how the captain officially died, we don't know that the various other passengers were as good or bad or whatever else as some are made to appear here. It's called dramatic license, it's the backbone of historical drama. Fine. But there's a line, and this should be it. As far as any official record is concerned, William Murdoch didn't shoot anybody and didn't shoot himself. There are stories of officer suicides from the sinking. That makes a certain amount of sense, but as close to official word as anyone generally has holds that Murdoch behaved heroically and likely saved dozens of lives by properly managing his section of the evacuation. And I'm sorry, it's one thing to have some of the real-life rich guys be dicks to Jack or say stuffy, clueless rich guy stuff to drive the points home, and another thing entirely to basically slander a guy when the few things we actually do know about him say he was a goddamn hero. James Cameron actually had to go to this guy's hometown in Scotland and officially apologize for this, and he should have.
Oh, not to worry. Quite normal for this time of year. In fact, we're speeding up. I've just ordered the last boilers lit.
This is the most bullshit thing in the movie, and worst of all, it's completely unnecessary. You want to stage the officer suicide because so many people claim to see one happen? Fine, make someone up. You made up Cal so you could have a bad guy, one more fake person isn't gonna kick your ass. But otherwise, there aren't really a lot of outright flaws in this movie. Some of it is because in some areas it doesn't really swing for the fences. The whole thing is such a technical risk that the narrative, judged on its own merits, is mostly guilty of playing it safe, meaning that it succeeds at somewhat less than challenging tasks. The problem isn't so much that various parts of the film are bad, but that they could have been better. The characters could be richer, more detailed, have more shades to them. The motivations and arcs could be more textured and ambiguous. Yes, melodrama calls for archly drawn characters, but that doesn't mean they have to be so overwhelmingly one-dimensional and simple. I mean, Citizen Kane is melodramatic. Those aren't naturalistic performances. Charles Foster Kane is practically a political cartoon in human form, but the film's characters still had depth and dimension to them. I'm not contradicting my earlier appraisal that the characters are good enough and drawn the way they are for a reason here. I'm just saying, yeah, a little more would have been a little better. Cal could have had some redeeming qualities or even some backstory to lay out why he was like he was. Jack could have had a few actual character flaws. You do that incrementally and you have an even richer, more satisfying movie without breaking the established setup of Rose being the only three-dimensional character in her own story, which I honestly do think is intentional.
So what happened next?
You mean, did we do it?
So yeah, not to get all Yogi Berra about it, but if Titanic was a better movie, Titanic would be a better movie, and it doesn't really have a reasonable excuse to not have been. And so we have Titanic, an overblown, underwritten, melodramatic cartoon of a movie that became the biggest thing in the world because it kinda deserved to, and then paid the price to popular culture by daring to have achieved that success without the endorsement of the gatekeepers of hipness. Today, so many years later, it holds up. This isn't the deepest film ever made, the best film of the 90s, or even the best thing that anyone involved ever did, but with the benefit of hindsight, there is just simply something about Titanic that clicked then and clicks now.
So serious.
We often talk about filmmaking like it's a hard science, but it's really closer to some kind of cosmic alchemy. What might have happened if it hadn't been James Cameron right at the end of his blockbuster phase, but right before his experimental tech guy phase? Or if it had been anyone but DiCaprio and Winslet just on the cusp of superstardom? What if CGI wasn't exactly good enough to do the sinking and the wide shots, but still limited enough that so much of it had to be a meticulously planned, deliberately staged soundstage shoot? What if they didn't get Celine Dion to do that song? By the way, am I the only person who misses blockbusters having dedicated songs? I mean, I guess that awful Nickelback thing for Spider-Man killed that, but most of the time you got a good song, right? Like, the average there was pretty good. My Heart Will Go On? Good song. I Do It For You from Prince of Thieves? Good song. When You Love a Woman? Good song. I Don't Want to Miss a Thing? Really good song. Isn't it kind of weird that we've had like 15 of these Marvel movies, and the closest any of them have had to a song was a Black Sabbath tune in the first Iron Man that wasn't even actually about that Iron Man? Like, nobody at Marvel has even ever said, hey, let's give Beyonce a couple million to cover I Need a Hero or something? Anyway, Titanic is a movie that is perfectly pitched to an adolescent psyche, which is probably why it was so immediately embraced by one audience upon release, and why other audiences have had to revisit it to really appreciate it, myself included. It's weird to think about one of the most popular and award-winning movies ever made being kind of underrated, but yeah, there it is. It has no pretense about itself, no shame or ironic mask to cover the sincere emotionality and earnest desire to impress, move, and leave everything on the table. So if thinking about your favorite moments from this movie can still make you misty, even though you know it's corny and shouldn't really work on you, it's time to stop feeling bad about that. Because Titanic is really that good.
I'm the king of the world!